Good morning. Recently, India got an acclaim for its good performance. United States President Donald Trump, while addressing the 73rd General Assembly of the United Nations, said India could lift millions of poor above poverty line. Then Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, goalkeepers, stories behind the data, 2018 said, it's because of India and China that more than 1 billion poor could be lifted above poverty line since 2010. It was the human capital expenditure that was said to be responsible for this, all this good work. The human capital expenditure, that is expenditure in health and education in India. And the Gates Foundation exerted upon the sub-Saharan Africa to emulate India. But one report that emerged amidst these acclamations is noteworthy. It did not praise. The Institute of Health Metrics and Evaluation, IHME, conducted a study at the behest of the World Bank that was published simultaneously with these other acclamations in Lancet Journal, that has shown India's rank in human capital to be 158, one notch below Sudan. Sudan's rank is 157. Yes, there was a little improvement in India compared to 1990. Then India's ranking was 162. So for this poor performance, IHME said poor investment in health and education and prevalence of disease was responsible. Yes, this is not really time for celebration. It is actually time for introspection. What's happening in India in health and education front? Taking the health first, health spending in India in recent year has been hovering around 1.3% of GDP. Compare this with the world's average, it is 6%. The National Health Policy 2017 targets health expenditure to reach 2.5% of the GDP by 2025. That means India does not have plans in the near future to scale up its investment in health to international levels. Let alone international levels, the high-level expert Committee on Universal Health under Dr. Srinath Reddy, which gave its reports in 2011, suggested the health expenditure by the government, state and central together should be at least 3%. This should be achieved in phases by 2022. But the government wants it to be, if at all it happens, to reach 2.5%. by 2025. Because of the poor spending by the government, 70% of the health expenditure is met by the people themselves. Government share is only 30%. So are the outcomes. Because of the poor expenditure by the government, every year 7% of the so-called non-poor are turning poor. They are falling below poverty line. Because of the heavy health expenditure by the people as a result of catastrophic diseases in the family, as many as 35 million fall below the poverty line. That 7% means it. Look at the NSS 71 report. 86% of rural and 82% of urban population do not have the coverage of any health scheme, although the successive governments have been boasting of many schemes for the benefit of the poor. And the NHS 71 points out 80% of the aged dependent aged, depend on the children for health expenditure. How can the children who are already poor can satisfactorily meet the health expenditure of the aged? That is the actual scenario in the country, whereas the international organization and President Trump acclaimed India, praised India for its good performance, and people do not get at least value for their money. The unethical practices of the health sector are innumerable. There have been instances of treating the dead, hiding the fact just to fleece the money. This is one single example shows how unethical are the practices. The rich are overtreated and the poor are not treated at all or undertreated. But health sector is flourishing. It is running like a commercial enterprise. There are as many as 10.4 lakh medical enterprises when the big and small are included. The size of the healthcare industry in 2017 was $116 billion worth. Now, with the avowed goals of correct these anomalies and strengthen the healthcare, a new scheme has been launched by the Prime Minister very recently. Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, Ayushman Bharat. PMJAY Ayushman Bharat. This scheme targets to cover 100 million families who feature in the socio-economic survey of 2011, which straight away means those who are not there in that survey are not going to get the benefit out of this. Of course, I'm not going into details of the flaws of this scheme right now in this video. But one thing prima facie, this is not a universal health coverage scheme. Non-poor are not covered under the scheme. All right. But the experience is, because non-poor are not covered and they cannot meet the health expenditure, they become poor. So we are lacking that vision that health care is the primary responsibility of the government. Turning to the education, similar is the experience. Spending is much lower than what is expected, and the outcomes are equally poor, like health sector. The education expenditure in 2012-13 was 3.1% of the GDP. That has further come down to 2.8% 2014-15, and then still further went down to 2.4% by 2015-16. There was a little improvement, but not much, in subsequent years, which was 2.6%. But that is nowhere near what Kothari Commission has suggested way back in 1966. Kothari Commission suggested health expenditure to reach by 6% of GDP by 1985-86 itself. There seems to be no plan at all to reach, although the Kothari Commission recommendation was accepted by then government. And needless to add, the poor infrastructure. Many schools do not have buildings of their own. As many as 18% of the schools do not have a toilet facility. Because of the poor or no toilet facility, 23% of the girls students drop out of the school. The other outcomes, if you look at the annual status of education report, ESSER, which mirrors the state of affairs in the education sector year after year for the several years that it has been doing that. As of 2017 says, 25% of the students in the age group 14 to 18 are not able to read a basic text in their own language, not English. 57% are not able to do a simple division, 3 digits by 1 digit. And then the teachers do not treat the students kindly. Teachers scare the students because of the corporal punishment in the schools. many students drop out. Government itself admitted the truth that in every school there is corporal punishment, in utter violation of the law against that. Students run away from homes, run away from schools because of bad teachers. Child protection, a handbook. Government's own publication says, in the name of discipline, the students have broken bones and teeth. They are humiliated. They are pulled by hair. No conducive environment at the schools. This doesn't require any additional money from the government. This suggests that there is deficit more in governance than in the spending. Still, we boast that we are able to develop our health and education, which is not a fact, as the ground realities suggest. So, these reports, these praises, these three cheats are the jeer from one organization. The government should learn and understand that for poverty reduction, it is essential to spend more in human capital, that is health and education. These two sectors are the primary responsibility of the government. It cannot delegate them, if it is a welfare state and a democratic country, to the private sector, the purpose of which is pure commercial gains. We can't run health and educational institutions for commercial purposes. It is for social purpose, for increasing the human capital in real terms. So better it is earlier that the government realizes this. These sectors should not be included in the government's populistic measure, whereby hurriedly some schemes are worked out and dished out, keeping an eye on the ensuing elections. At least these two sectors should be outside the market forces and outside the populistic schemes of the government. Let's hope government will think on these lines. Thank you for watching. Please do subscribe to my channel if you have not done already. Click that subscribe button below. Also that bell icon alongside so that you can get the notification automatically as and when I upload another video. Thank you.